Hi everyone, this is the fourth video on well logging, and in this video I am going to give you what we are going to read in further videos. I am going to give you classification of log measurements. What are the logs we have to study, and slightly I will give information about them. When we will discuss log by log, then we will have the detail analysis. Right now, see what we have to understand further. So the measurement are basically classified into two things. Either there will be a natural source or artificial source. Natural source or artificial source. So in natural source, what are the logs? The first is the natural gamma ray log. And what we will do in that log, we are basically measuring the gamma ray radiation from the formation. So it's a single detector device. Only detector is there, single detector device. Okay. So basically total gamma ray count is measured. And also there is a log which is called spectrometry gamma ray log. Also there is a log which calls spectrometry gamma ray log. So in that log, we try to measure how the elements are contributing to the energy. For example, when we are talking about natural gamma ray log, we are measuring the total energy. But in spectro gamma ray log, we are basically seeing how the individual elements are contributing to the energy. We will discuss it later. But right now, know that in the spectro gamma ray log, the count rays corresponding to the selected energy bands in the natural gamma ray log. Okay, all the selected energy bands we will study in spectro gamma ray log. And what are the uses of total gamma ray log? Evaporites, source or identification, shale volume, one of the most important application of gamma ray log. That is why it is also called shale log. But the shale volume we are correcting here is not 100% accurate. And depth matching, I've already told you, depth matching is one of the application of gamma ray log. Then there is also uses of spectro gamma ray log, mineral identification, evaporites identification, and else things are same as total gamma ray log. Now the second thing which comes in the natural sources, which is also a single detector device, is SP log. Here again, one of the most important uses of SP log is shale volume, formation water resistivity, permeable beds, and the shale sand interface too. That shale sand interface creates the potential. So recognition of that interface is also we will get in SP log. And the third win comes the borehole temperature log, and in temperature log we use the Horner plot. And the temperature log, one of the important uses of temperature log is that it is used in resistivity calculation. Basically what happens that in resistivity log, what we are measuring at some temperature and we want to calculate it at some other temperature, so in that case temperature log can be useful. So then is caliper log. And the one of the important uses of caliper log is the fracture identification, permeability. One of the most important uses of caliper log is the to know how much it is permeable, how the permeability, information of permeability is the most important application we get from the one of the most important uses we get from the caliper log. And other applications are lithology identification, in situ stress tensor are also identified. Okay, then a log comes in the natural sources is the inclination of hole. So how the hole is deviated, all this information we get from this log or azimuth log, what is also called. So now come the induced phenomena. Here the source and detector, both things are there. Previously we have seen that only detector was there, but here four source and detector both are there. So there are electrical measurements. So what happens is that by the emission of an electrical signal, okay, the source is here, the emission of an electrical signal. So there is a resistivity log, which is also called conductivity log, and using an electrode system basically. So there are two kinds of devices, long spacing devices and short spacing devices. In long spacing devices, what happens is that there is normal log and there is lateral log. These normal and lateral log are non-focused log. So what is focused log? What happens is that in the focused log, the energy is focused. It doesn't deviate through hole formation. It goes in a certain direction. That is why we call it focused log. Further, we will see all the applications. So right now, just know there is a normal log and there is a lateral log. These are electrical instruments, electrical log, which are non-focused. And when it comes to focus log, then we call it lateral log and spatially focused log. These are the focused log. Then there are micro devices. In micro devices, there are also non-focused log, which is called micro log. And there are also focused log, which is called micro lateral log or proximity log or micro specifically focused log. So what we get important information from micro devices is it is the resistivity of mud cake and the resistivity of flush zone. What is flush zone? We will discuss when we study in further video. We will discuss that what is flush zone. Right now, just know what are the uses of these things. And the third is the ultra long spacing devices. Also, there is high resolution deep meter. These come under electrical logging. There's also one log called induction log. And one of the most important thing about induction log is that we use here oil-based mud. And other previous devices, we cannot use oil-based mud. But here we are using oil-based mud. And there is also dielectric, basically electromagnetic propagation tool. We are using inductive coils here. So one of the most important uses of resistivity log is overpressure identification. So many times CSIR, NET and GATE examination, they have asked about overpressure. And this is one of the most important applications of resistivity log. Source rock identification, maturity, porosity and hydrocarbon saturation. That is why resistivity log becomes the most important log, because what we are basically interested in oil industry is that hydrocarbon. So hydrocarbon saturation, we get it from resistivity log. There's permeability identification, gas identification and detectors of thin beds by micro log. Because micro logs are basically they are micro devices and basically their resolution is very good. That is why we detect thin beds there, which is really really not good from the long spacing devices. Okay, so here comes nuclear measurements. So there is a irradiation of formation by neutrons, and there is irradiation of formation with gamma rays or neutrons, and we try to measure how the formation is reacting with this gamma rays. So what happens that in density log, the gamma rays are emitted from a source and the Compton scattered gamma rays returning from the formation are detected. So try to remember the Compton scattering gamma rays, which are basically the important feature of density log. So here we get bulk density of formation. Okay, we get the bulk density of formation. Bulk density means the matrix and the pore spaces, both are contributing to the signal. That is why we are calling it bulk density. So bulk density, there is a gamma-gamma log. It is also called gamma-gamma log. Why gamma-gamma log? Because we are giving gamma and we are measuring gamma. That is why it is called gamma-gamma log. There are some uses of density log, which is lithology, journal and fracture identification, source rock identification, porosity, the most important. Basically, we here measure total porosity, gas identification, acoustic impedance, and to calculate synthetic seismogram, we use the acoustic impedance. And acoustic impedance is basically the product of density and velocity. And there is photoelectric absorption coefficient. I think this log is not mentioned in the GATE syllabus, but still you should know about what we are measuring here. This is related to the mean atomic number. A low gamma ray log energy phenomena. Basically, the gamma ray is divided into low energy and high energy. Here we are basically considering the low energy. A low gamma ray energy phenomena is measured in addition to the density. That is why it is called lithodensity law. And the uses are quite similar: lithology, mineral identification, evaporites. And the third one comes right now is hydrogen index, basically the neutron law. The formation is basically bombarded by neutron and continuously bombarded by high energy neutrons, and which are slowed by successive elastic collision with atomic nuclei. Basically here what happens that the hydrogen nuclei is mostly responsible for the slowing down of neutrons. And why hydrogen nuclei is mostly responsible for the slowing down of neutrons? You have to answer this in comment section. There are several techniques. The thermal neutrons, i.e. those neutrons that have been slowed down to the thermal energy, we will call it neutron thermal neutron logging. Then there are gamma rays emitted when these thermal neutrons are captured by the atomic nuclei, then we call it neutron gamma logging. And there is also EP thermal neutrons, i.e. those neutrons not yet slowed down to the thermal energy. Like they are not yet slowed down to the thermal energy, then these neutrons will be called epithermal, and the related locking will be neutron epithermal neutron logging. What are the uses of neutron log? Lithology, total porosity again, shell volume. The shell volume we get from the neutron log is more correct than we are getting from gamma ray log. And gas identification, phases depositional, evaporites. There is a thing written: shell increases measured porosity, gas reduces measured porosity. So can you explain these things? Why shell increases measured porosity and gas reduces measured porosity? If you can, then answer in comment section. Otherwise, I have to discuss all those things. So do not get panic. There are also some neutron logs, and I think in the new syllabus of GATE, these are also included. Perhaps the question have not been asked in the previous paper, but they may ask. So there is a microscopic thermal neutron. Here what happens is that high energy neutrons are emitted in the short burst, and the rate of decay of neutron is measured. So there is a thermal neutron decay time. Also, sometimes what happens that the fast neutrons or inelastic interaction is also measured, and there is also called carbon oxygen logging, and also neutron capture is there, the capture gamma ray spectrometry. So all these things are included in the new syllabus. If required, we will also discuss this. Now again, here comes the proton spin relaxation time. What happens that basically we are talking about nuclear magnetic law and NML, and so basically what happens is that this magnetic field basically aligns the nuclear magnetic moment of the protons, and after the given field is removed, how these protons are precessing about the earth magnetic field, that is what we measure here. So after the pulse, the time required for the proton to formation to stop precessing about the earth's magnetic field is measured, and this gives us the relaxation time. And this relaxation time is highly important in the calculation of residual oil. One of the most important application of nuclear magnetic log is used to evaluate the residual oil. Then there are acoustic measurements. An acoustic signal is sent into the formation, and we basically measure how this acoustic signal takes the quickest path and return to the detector. So the P wave velocity from the transit time between the two receiver is measured, and that is why we will call sonnet log. And S wave also can be measured, so that we can have better information about the rock formation. And there is also amplitude logging, where we are measuring the amplitude of selected peak. And there is variable density logging, how this relative amplitude of the various components of the wave train are behaving. That is what is measured in variable density logging. What is the uses of sonic log? This is lithology, porosity. Here we calculate effective porosity. So here we are getting effective porosity. We are not getting total porosity from the sonic log, because the sound, what happens that sound wave takes the quickest path to the skeleton of rock, and that is why we are getting the effective porosity. If you're not understanding this here, we will discuss all these things when we study sonic log. But right now, understand, we are getting effective porosity from sonic log, and we were getting total porosity from neutron log and density log. But here, from the sonic log, we are getting effective porosity. Then there is a gas identification, fracture identification, overpressure identification, source rock identification, interval velocity, and acoustic impedance. Then there's also image logs, and these are basically fracture identification, permeability, hydrocarbon saturation. Okay, so in this video, I have given you the quick knowledge that what we are going to study further in the videos of well logging series. And I have thinking that you will have some brief idea about what are the applications, and when I will repeat this, then you will remember all the things. Okay. So thank you, and let's meet in the next video. Thank you.